Welcome to Collaborate 2020. We've got an exciting session for you guys. This session is called Switch and Adapt, and we're doing this in two parts. This first part is what makes changing ERPs worth the pain? Why would I go through this? And then once I make a ERP or a software technology shift, where do I go from there? My name is Brian Kaczynski. I'm one of the directors here at Viewpoint. I have on here my colleague, Wayne Newitz. Wayne, how about an intro?
Well, you've already introed yourself. I guess I'll do me. And I'm Wayne Newitz, Director of Marketing here at Viewpoint. Thrilled to be here at Collaborate, virtually seeing all of my good friends in two dimensions.
So a couple of housekeeping items as we move forward. So we do need to start with a legal disclaimer. Okay, the information you're going to receive is general direction. We're going to be talking to some panelists and going through this. So this is not a necessarily commitment, but this is basically a legal disclaimer that says we're going to be talking about some things, and it's going to outline the direction of Viewpoint also looking forward. The second thing, today we're going to be talking about Viewpoint One, okay? So Viewpoint One is a suite that's creating connections across the industry, across the contractor's business, from the back office to the field, back to the financials. Many have known us as an ERP for many years. It's much more robust than that. Everything from HR and project management and document sharing and drawing sharing. So Viewpoint One is the easy way to put data all in one spot and get guidance and make some decisions. So we're excited to have two guests here with us that are using our software, but are also going to talk through their story. The next thing is, many of you are looking for an opportunity to ask questions. You're going to get that here in the last 10, 12 minutes of the presentation. You're getting an opportunity. So right now, you can go to the chat function, open that up, and then as we're moving through this, you're going to be able to ask Lori, Craig, some questions as we move through that. And we'll let you guys know when that happens, okay? And the last thing is CPE credits. Yes, you can get them. You got to stay for the whole presentation, though. And at the end, once you get to the end, you can click on a link, do the survey, and then you'll be able to obtain CPE credits. And I know that's really important to a lot of the folks that are listening in. So without further ado, let me turn it back over to my colleague, Wayne, and introduce our panelists and our direction. Wayne?
Thank you, Brian. Yeah, we'll bring our panelists up to the virtual stage here in just a moment, but do let me share with you folks who we have the honor of speaking with today. We have Craig Lundskog with Great Basin and Lori Aker with Adelson and Peterson, two folks who I've had the pleasure of working with and speaking with in the past. We're thrilled to have you folks. We'll let you introduce yourselves here in just a moment. And let's talk a little bit, very briefly, about what we're going to talk about. So everyone now, raise your hand if you enjoy selecting and implementing new software systems. I don't see any hands raised. Of course, I don't see anyone other than Brian right now, but I can imagine that there weren't too many hands up. It is a painful process. We're not here to tell you differently. But the good news is that because it is a process, it's something that can be managed and best practices can be identified. And that's what we're going to be discussing with our panelists today. We'll cover the challenges, the variables, and the actions associated with making these sometimes difficult and painful selections for new technology, new software for your company, and importantly, how you can measure and realize return on these investments. So I'll turn it back to Brian now to just set the stage for a few minutes for what we're going to discuss and explain a little bit by way of analogy how we'll approach this issue. Brian, take it away.
Absolutely. Thanks, everybody. Thanks, Wayne. I'm a visual person and I like to get something in my mind so that I kind of understand a concept. That's just how I work, and a lot of people in our industry work that way. So let's step back from implementing software for a minute and think about an organization, right? So if I think about the idea of a control tower, so what does a control tower really do? So I called a friend of mine who's who works in, he's an air traffic controller. And I said, give me the functions. I think I understand this, but he said, look, it's three things. It's in-flight traffic patterns, right? I have things that are in flight up in the air that I've got to manage and flow. Then I've got to look down on the ground. And the primary look on the ground is traffic collisions, right? We're trying to keep people moving in a flow where they're not bumping into each other, planes, baggage handling. And the third thing is, it's all about collaborating the assets and communicating the people on the ground and in the air at the same time. And I loved that analogy because as I was looking through an article written by McKinsey, they had this exact same concept in there. They talked about, back in May, they wrote an article that talked about kind of pre-COVID issues that were going on in the industry. We know things like sustainability. We know things like supply chain, you know, evolution. We know things like digitization, data. All this stuff was, if you will, in flight, right? And then they realized that as they looked at this and we looked at our industry, post-COVID, we're seeing a lot of the same thing. Contractors are having to reallocate capital, move crews from one site to another almost on a daily basis. There's still the issue of data transformation. There's the challenges with an increase now in pre-construction activities, sustainable construction. All these things are moving together. But then they got to this interesting concept. They said, contractors that are successful, really at the end of the day, they're building what they call a control tower over the organization. And this is an interesting quote, right? I like this quote because it's talking about resource allocation. It's talking about the capabilities of a contractor to look in real time, have transparency across project process, their people, material inventory, subcontractor management, everything from contracts, services, costs. You've got to be able to coalesce all this into one area. And so I loved what they had said about this idea of a control tower across the portfolio. And so, you know, if you translate that a little bit and you think about this idea around a control tower for airports, and you translate that into what a business does, and I think about the in-flight traffic patterns, the things that are flying, they're in flight. I'm thinking financials, costs, materials, things of that nature. And when I think about ground collision, as my friend told me about, I thought, well, if I'm looking down on the ground, I'm thinking about projects. It's all about managing projects and the project process and the project management. And at the end of the day, the third function of an air traffic control tower is the same thinking. It's about being able to communicate and collaborate across an organization's assets and people. So I love the thought process. And really what it boils down to, and we're going to jump in here soon with Lori and Craig, is really at the end of the day, it's about data now. It's about being able to make decisions. Decisions equal data. I've got to have good, solid data. And really at the end of the day, it's dollars, right? Data means dollars. Data means making decisions. And at the end of the day, I'm profitable on projects. I can make those swift decisions. And that's what's been moving over the last 10 years into the industry. So when we think about construction for a moment, really at the end of the day, the top 20-ish percent of top performing contractors realize about 83% of the economic profit in the industry. If you reverse that translation, it means that 80% of contractors are about a break-even business. And we know it's thin margins. We know it's razor-thin margins. So we've got to find ways to do things at higher efficiency. That's where this concept of data comes in. That's where this concept of connected software, connected technology comes in. And that's what we find in the high-performing contractors. We see that. So let's move forward. So hopefully you got that concept. Hopefully you've got an understanding of this mental picture of your business in your mind. I'm going to turn it over to Wayne to meet our panelists and jump into some questions and let them introduce themselves. Wayne, go for it.
Thanks a lot, Brian. And appreciate the control tower analogy, as I haven't seen an airport myself in about 6 months. So losing all my status, it's a shame. Anyway, I am thrilled to be able to introduce our panel, or rather ask our good folks joining us to introduce themselves. So folks, come on down and let's, Craig, Lori, let me ask you folks introduce yourselves. I won't read the bios here. I'll let you add a little bit of color. Craig, since you're on the left-hand side of the slide, why don't you start us off? Tell us a little bit about yourself, Great Basin, what you do.
Yeah, I'm Craig Lundskog. I'm the Director of Finance here at Great Basin Industrial. I've been here for almost 7 years and helped us move over from QuickBooks over to Viewpoint. And I've actually implemented Viewpoint twice. I've become pretty familiar with how to do that, but I've also done multiple types of implementations. We recently just went to the cloud, which felt like a whole nother implementation. So that was really fun. But I've been in the industry for quite a while, 10 years plus. And then I was in another industry, the auto industry, before that. But I've interfaced with Viewpoint and their people for quite a long time.
All right, well, thank you very much, Craig. And it's great to see you again, albeit again in two dimensions. Now on to my good friend, Lori. Lori, tell us all a little bit about yourself, ma'am.
Hi, I work for Adelson & Peterson Construction, and we are a national general contractor who also does self-perform concrete. And I have been with the company for 33 years, and I was instrumental when we brought Forefront on our system along almost 20 years ago. And we've been involved in every upgrade, and we've also rolled out the construction. We've spun off a couple of our regions, and I've helped them get Spectrum up and running in those regions as well.
And much obliged. And I've had the privilege of knowing you, Lori, for a lot of those years, even back when the software was called Forefront and then Spectrum, and now, of course, part of Viewpoint One. But mm-hmm. But thank you so much for joining us yet again. I can't even count how many times you've helped and joined us in our communications to the construction community about software and technology. So thanks for joining, both of you. Let's go ahead and get started. Brian, if it's all right with you, since I'm on a roll, I'll grab the first question or topic here that we'll discuss around this whole idea of implementing new technologies for your company. And let's talk about the drivers. Starting at the beginning. What are and panelists, this is what I'll ask you guys to address. What are some of the indicators, red flags, yellow flags, however you'd like to say that, that you see or that your company should be aware of when considering a change in construction management software in particular? What finally makes you realize it's time to go through the process? And Lori, since I started with Craig earlier, let me go ahead and start with you. What were some of the drivers for change way back in the day and continuing on today at Adelson and Peterson?
I think the biggest thing is we are in multiple locations, and we had people doing things in many different ways. And to get a projection in a format that we all could see, instead of somewhere on an Excel spreadsheet that was not reliable, was the biggest concern that we had, was getting a system that would have that projection right there for, so anybody could have access to the projection. And we also, in the time that we were looking for something that would grow with us. And we not only brought on our ERP, we made a change to our estimating software, we made a change to our project management software, and we did a change in our CRM. So it was about a year's worth of time. ERP went first, but we just brought everybody along. And it was a commitment that the company made to say, as we grow, we need to have good technology for us to grow with,
Right. Sounds like you guys decided to, rip the proverbial multiple band-aids off all at once and just, do a really significant overhaul of your technologies there. Before we turn it over to Craig, tell us a little bit, what was the decision process to go ahead and make all of these changes roughly at the same time instead of, one after another? How did that play out?
I think the fact that we turned the corner and we're really starting to grow. We had just opened a couple more locations, had moved into different regions. So just making sure that we had everybody in the same on the same platform and communicating in the same manner. Also gave us the opportunity, if we were running the same software in each region, that if somebody needed to move to a region, go help out, we were able to be very flexible in that manner as well.
Oh, that's a great point there. Craig, tell us a little bit about your move. You mentioned QuickBooks and then on into a couple implementations of a more sophisticated software system. Talk us through a little bit about what were the indicators that you realized and your company realized that it's time to make a change, time to get off of a off-the-shelf software and move to something more industry specific.
Yeah, the first time I moved over to Viewpoint was in Oregon with a company called Fott & Company. And they were using an older version of Navision, which is now owned by Microsoft. And it just was not working. They had customized it so much and were so far behind in all their updates that I had to do something. And it was either get to the latest version of that software or move to something else. And I looked at everything and I analyzed everything at the time. And I felt like Viewpoint was the best fit. Back then, the software and the company was called Viewpoint. There was no Vista, there was no Spectrum. The company I came to work for here, Great Basin Industrial, they were on QuickBooks and doing $60 million a year on QuickBooks. And it was also job costing, obviously, and we were doing our payroll externally. So I knew as soon as I got on board that we needed to make a change. And I'd had a really good experience with Viewpoint before. And I knew that that was the software I was going to implement here as well. And so within months, we started the process after I got here to move over to Viewpoint. And it ended up being a really good process. And obviously since then, Viewpoint has grown a lot and changed and become metamorphosed into a better software company than they were then. I mean, they've got Viewpoint One now, you've got, you know, they bought on Keystyle and that became part of that Viewpoint One. And that was really transitional for us. I mean, moving our payroll, moving our onboarding of HR into that. And you know, I guess for us, the thing that made the biggest change is, as a financial person, I wanted to make sure that we are being as efficient as possible and that we're able to do more with less. And I don't mean less people, but yeah, less cost. And so, you know, we had, for an example, we had three people that would have to go on board when we would have these large shutdowns that we'd hire 50 to 100 people at a very short period of time. And I'd have to have three people go to the physical site to hire those people. And with the onboarding of HR management and how that whole thing works, I now can do all that at our central office here in Utah, anywhere in the country, because it's all done remotely and electronically, and I can do it with one person. So I can do that onboarding now with a lot less people. And there's many things like that that have happened with Viewpoint, where the economy of scale, where you know I'm getting a bigger bang for my buck. And so for us, you know, moving with a company, you know, I made the decision years ago to jump in with Viewpoint.
Would it be fair, Craig, to kind of sum up that one of the primary drivers for you in your career of implementing these new technologies has been, you know, kind of a simplification? Let's get rid of, 18 different systems and bring it down to a more manageable number of systems, as you mentioned, to get that economy of scale. Is that a fair statement? Am I characterizing
for sure.
that?
For sure. Yeah. We've used other software, like Lori was saying. We were using Excel spreadsheets to do many of our functions, and getting everybody using the same system and the same data is huge, because then and I'm sure we'll talk about this in a little bit, but you can do analytics reporting and other things that you can't do when everybody are using Excel spreadsheets and other things like that. So yes, everybody using the same software. The other thing that was really important to me is I've used other software and you try to implement them and, you know, the clunky importing of data from other systems is never fun and very, very, very yucky, for lack of a better word. It's just very painful. And this Viewpoint One and, you know, Key Style and the other things that, that Viewpoint has been bringing together, it, it becomes like they're all one system. You know, they all work together. They all write to the same tables. It's not importing anymore. And I love that. The importing pretty much for me has gone away. I don't do imports no more. And all of that's because, well, I take that back. I do have one software that's one of your partners that we still do some importing with, but I can't wait till that one goes away. But the importing goes away, and yes, one software, all done in one place. I mean, we're using a CRM software as well that's integrated well with Viewpoint, that is one of your partners as well. And so, yes, everything in one place, and the data is all there, and being able to share that data between our salespeople, our estimators, our project managers, and that data being the same for all is huge. And I know we'll talk about this more in a minute, but yeah, it's huge when you have all that data out there in one place that you can then manipulate and use and analyze and manage off of it. It's one system.
Yeah. Well, you know, and everyone's, you know, singing off of the same page in the proverbial hymnal. And, you know, Lori, that seems to, you know, your stories almost converge here, because it seems like for you at Adelson and Peterson with multiple entities, it was really vital to get all of these entities using the same software. So you're all using the same data. And I imagine reporting was a big driver for you folks as well, Lori, particularly in your role. Was the commonality of software across all of your different corporate entities, was it helpful for reporting for you as well?
Yes, it was. I mean, we, you know, being able to pull everything into one report, you know, the consolidation feature, being able to have all those separate entities consolidated, have one financial statement, it has saved, you know, just a lot of time during, you know, a month end process. And, you know, being able to just access the data, have everything there, you know, what's in the system. You don't have to worry about, is this really up to date, or am I looking at really old data? So, you know, being able to just have that line of sight, the visibility into where projects are at, you know, it has just been really helpful. You know, the being able to see the invoice approval, knowing, you know, today I'm closing month end, and it's like, how much, you know, where are we at on invoices, you know, just so that we know we can get everything updated. In the past, we would never have had that capability.
Right. I mean, yeah. Lori, hold on. You're joining us for this when you're closing month end. Thank
yep.
you.
Yes,
thank you so much. We'll it's speed actually, it up for you.
It's actually quarter end too. So.
Oh, that's right. Isn't it? Oh my goodness. Okay. A special thanks for joining us today. No, thanks a lot, folks. And audience, please, if you have any comments or stories that you'd like to share with us about your decision process, what drove you to make a decision to implement new technology, whether it be construction software or any significant investment, let us know. Use your use the chat question function here, and we'd love to hear from you. Panelists, thank you. Let me turn it back over to my buddy Brian. And Brian, why don't you take the panelists through the next question or two, please, sir?
Yeah. So you guys talked about a lot there, and you know, we've got a lot of people online, obviously, listening in on this, and you've talked a lot about Viewpoint. It's obvious, and we've, as Wayne said, blushing a little bit at the appreciation. But you know, in all fairness, organizations have to go through a process, right? You've got to go through and understand where the gaps are. We talked a little bit about the drivers. Obviously, there's a selection in using us, but if you were to give some advice around what your process of as how you assessed all the options, Viewpoint's not the only, you know, project management, you know, financial software out there. There's a lot of good ones. You know, there's a lot of options in the industry today, much more than there were 10 or 15 years ago. So starting with Craig, would you kind of go through, you had experience with Viewpoint, but there's an analysis that kind of has to be done to recognize my organization, you know, needs to assess these options. Software technology has to have this type of functionality. Was there a process that you went through to assess what options would work better than QuickBooks or whatever project management or HR software, as you mentioned?
Yeah, we'd other, you know, I'd used other HR and onboarding software as well. So I had tried other options. And so I had some experience with what was out there. And even today, there's way more review online companies that you can go look at software. I won't name any of them, but there's lots of them that you can go out there and look at software. There was some of that when I did the review process. So I would look at reviews. I would look at, you know, the internet obviously has exploded with information over the years. And when I first did the review, there wasn't much on the internet, but I had 10 companies that we looked at. I think was my goal to have at least 10 software companies that I started with. And then I narrowed it down to 3. And then from there, I interviewed, went through specifically going through the companies. And it wasn't just about the software. It was getting to know the people and the company itself. That was really the most critical thing to me. Is software can all do wonderful things. And a software salesman will make it look like it's great, right? But will it really do what you need it to do? And to me, that was the people. You know, it was the people and the help desk and the support. And if there was an issue, how did they work through it? Because there's always going to be issues and concerns when you implement software. And so when those problems arise, is the company going to be there to support you? Do they have the support capability and the background in their support to be able to have the experience to work through things? And that's, you know, how I narrowed it down as I interviewed specifically with the companies. But I analyzed every software that's out there. And, you know, I jumped into it and made the decision based off of everything, the software, the people, the direction of the company. That's the other thing that was a big deal to me is where do they see themselves in 5 years, 10 years? And, you know, pretty much everything that was on, you know, the forefront. I mean, you guys have been very forward thinking way back then. And a lot of the things have happened. I mean, it's metamorphosed into something even greater, in my opinion, than I think was thought of back way back then. So it was a decision based on all those factors. And then was it a good fit for us as a company? Did it fit the way we did business and the way we wanted to be able to do business? And so, yeah.
Excellent. No, yeah, I agree. For the audience that's here, you've got to be able to assess all the options. You got to line everybody up. And like you said, what's going to work best for my organization? And that's a fair thing to do. A little shortlisting, it sounds like what you did. Yep. So fair process. Lori, how about yourself? Did Elfson Peterson go through like a process? Did you maybe set a working group up? I mean, is there some best practices? You said, we're going to line up all the options and we're going to take a look in these things, these options, these, you know, functionalities, these matter to us. And we're gonna stack them all up and take a look at what works best for us. How did you guys go about that?
Yeah, we hired a firm to come in and interviewed numerous people. I mean, they spent about a month. And I remember my interview was probably 3 hours long. So they spent a lot of time with a lot of different people to see what we needed. And from that, they came, you know, they knew the software companies. So then they sent out RFPs, they got the information in, and then they narrowed it down to 3. And then we had demonstrations by the three firms that they had recommended it. So, you know, it was quite a long process for us. And, you know, the commitment I think that the company made by actually bringing in outside people, you know, we all knew what we wanted, but I think having that outside group of people say, well, this really is what's going to fit you better than having a bunch of people, no, I want this. I think it worked out for us in the long run.
Using an outside firm. Yeah. That's another best practice. That's another way to go. Bring in a third party that's, you know, not committed to one or the other, just can assess what the organization needs, or Craig having, and yourself having experience with a variety of companies, you know? So yeah, I mean, I think the, you know, being able to assess the options, and I think for the folks that are listening in, there's a variety of ways to do this. You know, there's a variety of ways. It's not just about Viewpoint or other folks that are out there. You got to fit. It sounds like you both did the same thing, that you looked at what was best fit for the organization.
Yep.
Yes.
So, okay. So, I mean, How did you, so if I move to the next question and I looked at this last question around, you know, the factors, can you describe the final factors that, was it something, and I'll start with you, Lori, was it something that they had in this third party assessment that finally, what was the final decision factor that drove the final decision? The factors, I guess you could say. What was it? Was it some functionality? Craig had mentioned things like relationship with the organization or trust in the help desk. I mean, there's a myriad of things that a lot of folks listening in would stack up and say, these are important to us, you know, and they're going to drive the final choice in making this pretty sizable change, as we talked about at the front of the program. This is not easy. And part two, we're going to talk about that with you guys for tomorrow. But today it's, we got to make a choice. Lori, what final factors for you guys, you know, made that final decision for you?
I think, you know, based on the majority of the items that we had on our wish list, who could meet a lot of those items? And, you know, and some of those items did not have to be right at that moment in time, but knowing that there was, where the potential was of, you know, just talking to the companies, finding out their vision, where they're going to go, you know, are you going to grow with us? I mean, that's a big thing. You know, we've probably doubled or more in size since we made this decision, you know, and we're still with the same company. So that was a factor that we looked at, is to make sure that they're going to be sustainable and be with us for a long time, because it's a big commitment. And I can still remember it like it was yesterday. So, I mean, it was, you know, it was a big job. And I think, you know, when we did meet the people, it was the values, as Craig said, just getting to know the people, spending time with the people. You know, it's just seeing, not just hearing what a salesperson has to say, but seeing what is to offer and what is available and the resources, the support. You know, for me, the support was a big deal, because, you know, especially when you first go on a software, you're on speed dial to support, and just knowing that the people there were going to be there for you was probably the largest factor for us.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. It's amazing that this industry is still about trust and relationships and belief in the long-term partnerships. I think that is still how we assess so many different suppliers. We, even at Viewpoint, as we look at partners, right, we're doing the same thing. And I think that's wise for folks that are listening in to hear kind of what Lori had to say about that. You've got to look at the long term. It's true. Craig, how about yourself over at Great Basin? I mean, what was the final factors? You had a lot of experience with Viewpoint, but you also assessed 10 other companies to look at various functions. It came down to a few things, right? How about for you guys at Great Basin? What drove the final decision to say, we're going to pull the trigger on this, and here's why?
I think it came down to three things. One was the cost, the return on investment, how it fit within our company, and then, like Lori, was the company going to grow with us? Because we've also almost tripled in size since we went with and made that decision years ago. And do we have a partner? Do we have somebody who's going to grow with us? And that's definitely been the case. Our job is to go out and get as many jobs as we can and be as profitable and manage those jobs on a day-to-day basis. That's our job. And you guys help us with that somewhat. But your job is to go out and find the latest technology and go find the best partners and go out and find the best alternatives. And you guys, and Viewpoint's definitely done that. I mean, Lori came from a whole different company at one point, was not part of Viewpoint when she bought the software, but they became part of Viewpoint. And you know, and that's happened with many of the things that Viewpoint's been doing. And I feel like it's a great partnership. Has there been ups and downs? Yeah, I remember a couple of years ago I got in an executive board meeting and I was pretty vocal about the customer support that had kind of taken a dip. And I got good feedback from it. And I've noticed a bunch of changes in the customer. And, you know, there was some promises made back then. The customer support was going to get better. And it has. It's gotten way better. And it's not just the phone calls. They've given us all these avenues to go out and find stuff. You know, the knowledge base, the chat feature, the you know, all the technology that now is available, the whole new platform to be able to do training and also be able to have your positions be certified. And that's, you know, a new function that's happening on the training side. So all those things are now coming about because you guys are going out and doing your job, which is software, getting the best software and the best solutions for us as a construction company. And then from our side, we're going out and becoming better at what we do. I know that, you know, and that air traffic control thing about the three things that are out there. And I think we haven't focused as much on the people side. And I'd love to talk about that is, and I know that in a recent O-Shift session that when you did a poll, that the biggest thing about implementing software is the people, and do they get what you're trying to do? And that's the other piece that I really like about the software is it's becoming easier to use.
Yeah, absolutely. No, and I think with anybody listening in, I think you guys touched on a lot of significant factors, whether it's Viewpoint or not. I mean, you got to be able to trust what the software can do for you, and it's got to have the transparency, and the functionality is important. User interface, we got people in the field that it's like 1 to 2 clicks to get something done. You know, you've got to get that invoice processed or a change order or whatever. So I think anybody listening in, I think you see here, Craig and Lori giving you some anecdotes on how do you line up. You could use a third party company to come in. You could look at all the data yourself. You could form a working group in your company. There's lots of ways to look at this, but I really appreciate you guys. Craig started touching on some implementation. Hey, this is only part one. So we're gonna go into this, a little bit further in depth tomorrow. So Wayne, I'll turn it back over to you for some final thoughts and final, what's the word I'm looking for?
Housekeeping.
I lost my word. Go.
All right.
I was going to say yucky like Craig. That's a technical term. I like
it. We might have to bleep that out. I don't know. This is a family audience here, Craig. My goodness. One thing, kind of a thread that was running through both Lori and Craig's discussion was, although this is a discussion about technology, people were brought up multiple times. And, I think to state what I know is the obvious, but it's important to remember that technology is just the means to the end, right? We're all trying to work better, work safer, work in uncertain times. Having a technology and choosing a technology partner with whom you can establish the relationship is one of the key things that I have seen over my several years in the industry be, again, one of the big factors. So thanks for bringing that up, folks. Housekeeping wise, so we have multiple resources for you here at Viewpoint. If you are one of our clients, and again, hopefully, you know, Lori and Craig both referenced some of these in their discussions, but we have the ability, to get support through multiple channels. We have a university that frankly, I thought I was done with school until I joined Viewpoint as part of one of the acquisitions that Craig was mentioning. But we've got quite a university for learning enablement for customers or for folks who just want to learn a little bit more about industry topics as well. And then our network, the Viewpoint Network, available to any and all of our clients, is a great community. I know Lori, Craig, I confess I don't know about your participation, but I know Lori is a big time participator in the network. It's fun. We have a bunch of challenges and you can win prizes and win games, but more importantly, you also learn about what's coming up. And that's also key because as has been mentioned, our situations change, our circumstances, the economy, but also technology is changing and continuing to do so at an accelerating pace. So staying on top of what's here now and what's coming tomorrow is very important. And that's something that we here at Viewpoint take a strong commitment to providing to our clients. So I do want to mention as you're here with us now at Collaborate, please, don't miss your chance for all of the different interactions that you can have here. We have the Viewpoint Academy, the Viewpoint Network at Viewpoint Central that you can connect with. You can visit our expo hall. We have a number of partners. Again, Craig mentioned several of them. We've got a large ecosystem of folks who we're privileged as one of the leading providers of software to work with in the industry. While we do have an integrated Viewpoint One system, we don't do it all for everyone all of the time. And that's why we have partners. Please take a moment, visit them, go to our exhibit hall and check them out. And if you haven't signed up for the Viewpoint Network, please do. And if you're not sure how to do that, hit us up in the question and chat area. I think at this point, we can go ahead. Panelists, if you're ready, feel free, by the way, to take a sip of whatever beverage you may have. I know we're in different time zones, so no judgment here, whatever that beverage may be. And let's launch into some Q&A, if everybody's ready for that. Lori, Craig, ready for some Q&A?
Sure.
Let's do it.
Welcome, everybody. Thank you for joining us. I hope you're enjoying your day at Collaborate. It's not ideal that we're not in a big conference room together or in separate conference rooms, rubbing shoulders and connecting. I know it's difficult, and I miss it. I really do. It's a lot of fun to, be with our customers and even those that are, not Trimble or Viewpoint customers. It's hard to see Lori and Craig on the screen here because we love them and we like being around them. So this is the point in time for about 10 minutes. We've got some Q&A, a couple quick things. You heard Wayne and I both talk about it. You got to hang on. In the chat feature, there's going to be a survey. After the survey, you can obtain CPE credits, which is important. This is only part one of part two. We talked a little bit about today about process and selection. Tomorrow is going to be more about Craig and Lori discussing implementation and adoption. So there's a whole other piece of this that is important as a contractor to understand. I've got to make a selection, but then I got to get it moving into the organization. They got a whole other story for tomorrow. So come back to that. Wayne, it's my understanding I did see a bunch of questions coming into the chat here. What do you got? And
we do,
Lori, Craig, yeah. You guys are both good. Thank you for joining us again. Appreciate it.
Problem.
So absolutely, folks, they're coming through like a ticker tape here, so I'll grab one that grabbed my eye. Came in one of the first questions, and I'm just going to toss that. This will be a toss-up ball between you both, Lori and Craig, and it's how did you get all departments on board for a single software? So it's a direct quote. So either one of you fine folks want to grab that one?
I can jump in real quick, and then Lori, you can fill in some stuff if you want. We did it a piece at a time. So we did, for example, we did payroll first, and then we did accounts payable, and then we did AR, and then we did job costing. I mean, they all kind of rolled out about the same time, but we did all the background work. And then we rolled them out. So that was the first thing we did. And then jumping in and doing continuous training with each one of the departments, especially on the project management side. Most of our guys were used to using spreadsheets and other ways of keeping track of the costs and the things on their jobs. So it was change for them. And, we all know that you only retain 20% the first time you listen or hear something in the first place. So we knew that we had to at least 5 to 7 times go over this stuff with them. So we didn't have the assumption, oh, we showed you once, now you know how to do it, right? So we did a weekly training for a couple of months, actually for about a quarter, 3 months. And then after that, we did a training every month. And then we recorded these trainings so they could go back and watch them if they needed to. So that's how we got all the departments on, and we did focus on each department. The biggest department was the project management department. And definitely the most challenging to get on board. So,
right. Lori, would you concur with what Craig has mentioned there, and have anything you wanted to add or compliment that with?
I do. I agree. The project management team, it was, you know, the biggest transition for them. So spending a lot of time with them and getting them up to speed with doing projections, we had to make some changes for them. You know, we did some custom programming to help them out a little bit. The one thing that helped us in our company was the fact that our management said, we're making a change and everybody needs to be on board with this change. So I think, you know, coming with that started, it helped. But the fact that we did roll out our ERP system first, I think the company learned a lot for the next other processes that they rolled out at the same after us, because you can't just push it at people. People have to, they have to feel like they have a little bit of ownership. And I think, you know, just getting everybody on board was the big thing.
Right. All right. Well, you know, thanks, guys. And Brian, I think maybe this one is one I'll toss your direction, sir. It's I keep hearing Viewpoint presenters say how it's great to have all this data in one place. But then hear other people asking, when will Spectrum speak with Vista and Teams and Analytics and Viewpoint One, et cetera. So, so is this truly an integrated system, ERP, HRM, et cetera, or will we still have to have separate solutions to get everything we need in one place? There you go.
That's a doozy, man.
This is a tough audience, but that's a good question. So
very good question.
How would you address that, sir?
Yes. So at a high level, and we've got. So okay, we talk about Viewpoint One. It's an integrated suite across the board. Yes. Then at the base of that is two ERPs, financials. So all the project management work that Craig and Lori's teams are doing from the field, and then we've got team data, we've got all this other stuff funneling in, have come into two different ERP systems. So the best way to answer that is this. We run two financial systems that are all both Viewpoint One integrated suites. Now, as we move towards integration and collaboration amongst those suites, depending on how those suites work, we have different levels of where a lot of the bolt-on, call it HR, call it project management, are working within those systems. So we're continuing to evolve that, right? Viewpoint was Vista, then we bought Dexter and Cheney, which was Spectrum. We brought that into the fold. Trimble bought us, and on we go. So we're running two financial systems. Speaking between the two of those, I couldn't be honest with you. I couldn't speak to something specific about that, because both of those systems are fit to contractors in different frameworks, right? Whether you have a service module, whether you're a GC that doesn't do any self-performance, right? Depending, this is the beauty of Viewpoint holistically, is that there are multiple suites depending on the stylistic way you run your business. Am I a specialty sub who does service? Am I a GC who really doesn't self-perform? Am I a civil contractor that has ticketing at a quarry and I'm running aggregate through, right? There's so many different ways to look at this. And it's very nice to have a couple of different modules. Within Viewpoint, what we try to do is continue to advance our technology around analytics and Viewpoint One. Viewpoint One exists in both ERPs. So it's almost like you have to think Spectrum Vista, I'm sort of beginning to drop that down. In time, I couldn't speak to a point when they would come together, but we continue to work on different platforms, and we continue to work on different M&A acquisitions. We continue to work on different strategic, third-party folks that we're working with. So it's a very good question. I mean, and we get it. Like, we understand that there's a bit of confusion sometimes in the industry. Viewpoint One is where you need to start. Then I'm a contractor that does X. We get with our salespeople and our experts, and we try to figure out what module solutions work best for you. That's the beauty of it. It's not just one system. We've got a variety of solutions that go along with our technology. Craig and Lori are talking about that. They're both very different companies. Adolphin Peterson and Great Basin do very different things. Energy versus commercial versus, you know, GC related work. You've got two really interesting folks here on the line to do two very different things. So what's important is partnering with people that can look at the solution and understand how to drive those workflows and build something for you that works for your business. So probably didn't satisfy the full answer, but that's kind of where we stand today, right?
Well, no, thank you very much. And as always, folks, you can chat with any and all of us. Brian, we'll be here. We're living and sleeping in our Viewpoint shirts here over the next 2 days. So you can chat us up anytime. So, you know, if whoever would like to more information about Viewpoint One from us and from Brian. But thank you. So now back, we have just a couple more minutes here. And as Brian mentioned, got to hang through to the end, folks, get to that survey to get those CPE credits. But I did want to toss this one back out to our panelists, Lori and Craig. And it's as follows. We have been on a legacy software for 30 years. And while the vast majority of employees are wanting a change and know a newer software will benefit the organization, our only option is to upgrade to Viewpoint. So evidently they did not have a say in this. Should I be concerned that my team will not have a say in the software? So, I mean, I think the answer is probably yes, but maybe providing some nuance or some guidance, Lori or Craig, how would you respond to this individual's concerns? I'll toss it up to either one of you.
So for us, it was a decision we made at the executive level. We did have input when we made the decision, but there was no way for us to have our 350 employees say, yeah, I want that software. There's just no way for that. But we did try to include the employees a lot, and we did learn when you include them in your decision-making that they embrace it. And it doesn't mean they get necessarily a choice in the software, but they can have a choice in the way you do things. Mm-hmm. Because there are many decisions to be made when you implement a software, and there's many ways of doing things. So if you bring them in and have them have feedback, and that's those weekly meetings we had, it wasn't just us teaching them. We would listen to them a lot, and they'd give us, okay, well, this is what we're seeing, or this is what we're experiencing. Can you give it, you know, and then we'd talk about it. And we also had a consultant that was helping us through this whole process at the same time. And we might have, you know, done some customization or created a custom report or done some custom programming in regards to what they wanted. So there is options. You just include the employees after the fact.
Okay. Lori, would you concur, or does the process work a little bit different at Adelson and Peterson?
No, I agree. You know, the decision was made by a few people. But keeping everybody involved is the big thing. Getting feedback. I know, we made changes to a lot of things at the time we implemented. So making sure that everybody was on board with the different changes that we made, mm-hmm. with the different structure changes, with the GL structure and those kind of things. And just keeping it out there, keeping everything out there for everyone to hear about it. And like I said, we got on the system. Things weren't working quite like they did in the past. We had to get a couple custom programs, and I mean, it's just one of those things that happens until you really get in there and try it. Sometimes things just don't work the way you really want them to work, but you just really have to keep an open mind.
Right, right.
I think one other quick thing to add to that is remember the adage, you'll never make everybody happy.
Right.
There are going to be unhappy people when you do stuff, and you just have to deal with it.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah,
what works best for the organization, you know, you gotta line that up. You know, it's critical.
Yep. All right. Well, ladies and gentlemen, I think we are just about at time now. Please remember, stick around for a second, get the survey filled out, get those CPE credits. But regardless, we'd love to hear your feedback on this session. Did you find it instructive? Would you like to see more of this going forward from us and from our wonderful customers and guests, panelists today? Lori, Craig, thank you so much for joining us. But we're not done. We'll be back tomorrow, I believe.
Part two tomorrow.
Absolument. All right. Well, great.
Happy to say.
Thank you.
Thanks, all.
Thanks, everyone.